So for Wirral, we've got three cars here. Wirral was the third car that we implemented and operates from 2 o'clock in the afternoon till midnight. And what we know from our demand, we had a discussion with CWP yesterday and indeed everywhere across Merseyside, demand goes up at midnight, so just as the car's going off, so maybe that's a future discussion. And the other two cars that have been running slightly longer, Nosley and St Helens are now moving towards a day shift as well, because we know that there are people with mental health problems that contact the police, certainly between the hours of 10 o'clock and 10 o'clock in the morning and 2 o'clock in the morning. So we're moving to that probably around April of 2017, and we've got a couple of test day shifts as well. And what we're able to do with that is, and it enables us to share practice and talk to each car saying, well, that's worked with this car, can we try it? So we found it really successful. And as you can see from the commissioning, it's something that we have to work with, but obviously in these times of austerity, sometimes the commissioning only comes in for 12 months. And certainly from a Merseyside Police point of view, we will work with that, but sometimes it gives us difficulties in recruiting the right staff, because we don't want to come from a permanent job to a 12-month contract. But we collect quite a lot of data, and this is the car activity. We don't measure one against the other, but Wirral car is the pink version here. The spike towards the end of the line is we put a permanent police officer on Monday to Thursday, and we pick that up from the other cars. What we know is we had a cadre of staff, and that meant that the police officer was only doing that job every now and again. But what we know is we can build expertise, and the relationship between the practitioner and the officer in the car is much better if we have a permanent officer. So that's where that spiked.
Yeah, as you said, there's the three graphs. Top one is obviously there's a care of Liverpool. everywhere's different. There's no sort of comparison in that. However, what we would say is for 136 is the Wirral is second. So compared to the three cars that we have, so the Wirral will be second in there. We now pan everything with Merseyside approach, so we look at everything, sort of pan Merseyside to really help get the picture of where it's going. But that's an example of the data that we've left, and that is updated continually really for us. And at tomorrow our strategic governance meeting, where demand on this and the times that it takes for people to get through places of safety is discussed and scrutinised at a high level.
We've got lots of other data, so we can look at what was offered at scene. Was it by telephone? Was it face-to-face? We can also say where that was. Was it in private premises or a public place? The one thing we can measure is 136 detentions. It's very difficult, because of the way our systems record things, to know what our true mental health demand is. But what we know is about 80% of the triage contacts are actually in the person's own home. And that's where, prior to triage, we had a great difficulty, because we don't have any powers for that, other than requesting a 135, which isn't a quick time thing. So the triage car has really assisted in getting that right intervention at the earliest opportunity. You're talking about recovery and earliest intervention. For us, this is the earliest opportunity you can get. It's before arrest, it's obviously before prison. So we think that's a really good aspect of the car. As I said, one thing we can measure in Wirral from the 12 months prior to
TCAP will look at the individual, will consider whether their diagnosis and everything points towards a TCAP, and if so, what a TCAP in place. Now, what a TCAP is, it's simply an agreed process or protocol between mental health services and the police in looking at preventative ways of stopping that person from calling or treating that person correctly if they do call. It's like a problem solving approach to reduce child abuse, and really focusing on that with the triage officer and the mental health officer and police member staff. Now, we've spoken about going to days. This is something where I think we've agreed that going on to days really helps because the high demand generators that call the police who are drunk at 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock in the evening, they can be spoken to at 9, 10 o'clock in the morning when they've not had a drink or when they've not taken drugs or when they're different put together mental health crisis. So really effective, and maybe we'll discuss some of the examples now.
So the Triage Car Action Plan, we just started about maybe 5 weeks ago, our first one on the Wirral. But as you can see, we love graphs in the police, so more graphs for you. This was a lady who was open to mental health services. In an 18-month period, she called Travel 9 440 times. She'd been open to mental health services for over 20 years and had quite a chronic illness. And she had a paranoid type of presentation to her illness, so she was truly believing that somebody had been in her house, that somebody tampered with her electricity, and she was very frightened and she was dialing Travel 9 because she wanted our assistance with that. There was never any evidence of that, and you know, at the end of the day, it was definitely part of their mental health presentation. When we started looking at this lady and the calls and the information from the calls, we were able to pass on basically evidence of her mental health presentation to the care team, and the care team were not aware that she was calling to this extent, and it was often that she was able to mask it for the 10 minutes that maybe the nurse had a chat with her on, I think it was maybe a bi-weekly or three-weekly basis, but then after that she was quite distressed, quite frightened, she lived alone, so we agreed a plan with the trust, and as you can see the calls really dropped because the trust was able to offer more support to her, and in fact when we shared the extent of the information and the content of the information, they actually realised she was more unwell than they thought because she was able to mask it. And it did result in her being detained and going into hospital for some period of time. But at the end of the day, that was the best option for her. So this lady was, so that's, you know, excessive calls. What we get sometimes, if you all think how many times you dial Travel 9 in your life, it won't be, hopefully, that many times. So for somebody to start, an elderly lady to start in December, to start calling us in sort of a 3-week period, call Travel 9 16 times, that's quite a lot. And again, she was paranoid, but not as obviously so. The police officers were attending, deploying on an emergency response. And we were submitting what's called a vulnerable person report. The presentation wasn't that she needed some urgent action and an ambulance, etc. But she was quite depressed, a little bit, quite depressed at what she thought was going on and a little bit confused. As soon as we put triage in place and the triage car action plan, basically what all that did was that the nurse practitioner contacted the GP and relatives. And she didn't call us again because obviously there was some memory issues going on and it was basically a dementia onset. But that hadn't gone to health, it had gone to the police because of the way she was presenting. And finally, the last example, this is another gentleman who's called us for in excess of a decade and been over to mental health services for a couple of decades. He called us 731 times via 999 in an 18-month period. And again, well known to services. And you know, this gentleman is now almost a way of life, calling the police because it's gone on for many years. But what we've been able to do is a more joint approach, share information, the care team and now fully embrace what he says when he calls, because often the content is quite delusional. And we were able to reduce the calls to us, and the care team are able to go in at different times. This is the proactive side.
something like that, and I went to a negotiating meeting since the other day at Wellbeing Street Tech Park, and I was the only negotiator. That would allegedly the PTPs on the cost of the PTP to show up at the delays that it puts on that services. And that was that related to 2.5 hours or something like that, you know, to like.
Have any role in that?
We have lots of contact with problem we have with measuring is we don't know how many we took to A&E for mental health purposes, or in fact for any purpose at all, because our systems, we have a coded system which is around crime and concern, but there isn't an A&E, so you'd have to do word search on how many, you know, and we get, how many calls we get a day, so we get at least a million calls a year, I know that. So we'd have to search on A&E to pick out every log, to read through it, to say, did we take that person to A&E? So we haven't got figures that we can measure against with triage card. But what we have got is if we've avoided A&E, so the officer going, if you weren't on triage card, would you have taken to A&E or not? And that's the only way we can measure.
And what we have seen is a massive reduction whilst the triage card is on duty. So between the Wales case, say 4 and midnight, we've seen a reduction in those times, whereas we've seen an increase between during the daytime when the triage car isn't available. So the triage car is looking at interventions and different ways of dealing with that person. Does that make sense?
Yeah,
sorry,
it doesn't answer the question about the reduction in footfall. So
one of the issues historically has been that So the idea was about trying to get this message across, and we're partly here today, I suppose, the fact that I'm here, is to make sure that the housing offer can be picked up by colleagues in health and social care, because my presentation will demonstrate, I hope people realise, housing, good quality housing is quite a determinant of good health. So that's by way of introduction. In terms of housing associations, we manage across the whole city region, which includes Halton, over 150,000 homes. And clearly that is quite a big chunk of the population. In fact, 15% of the population rent from the housing association, almost one in seven households. Whilst we actually manage homes, we've built over 1,600 homes over the last 3 years. And we have plans, which part of the offer to the Liverpool City region is to actually up our game to help build the houses that the region needs. In terms of businesses, we're also quite a large employer. We employ over 6,500 people across the region. There are about 22 of us, I think, that operate across Merseyside. So we can see that we have a big part to play, but we are very much individual organisations, and as I say, hence coming today to try and get across what housing associations can offer health and social care. We've spent quite a lot of money in terms of our day-to-day arrangements, managing and repairing our homes and making quite a contribution to the local economy, adding 1.2 billion to the GBA each year. So that's just by way of a quick background. I think in terms of the presentation today, it's very much about what the housing offer is to the city region. So I won't dwell too much on this, but it originally started, as I say, as about offering the ability to build the homes the region needs through housing supply and helping develop the housing strategy, what sort of houses, what sort of accommodation, in which areas, in what sort of tenures. So, for instance, there is a need for those areas where we've got economic growth to have maybe more family accommodation, but in some areas, particularly with the ageing population, about providing more supported housing. So helping understand the housing strategy required to meet the needs of the constituent boroughs. But this presentation is around that third point, number three, about health and wellbeing, because housing associations are much more than just bricks and mortar. We're not just about building homes and maintaining them. A lot of the work we do is about trying to make sustainable communities. Many of the people we house have deprivation, probably don't have many other housing options, and they come to us for accommodation and may have other issues. So it's very much around our work is doing more than bricks and mortar, and two areas particularly. Helping in our attempts to learn skills and get employment, so we do an awful lot of work in terms of trying to skill some of our residents. And a lot of this is done through in our communities, which also then links into health and wellbeing. We at Magenta Living, we've got about 15 tenants and residents organisations who have facilities across the piece, and very often their community facilities are being used for all sorts of things. I'll come on to that a bit later about maybe the offer that we can make to the health and social care agenda. As I said before, I think there's quite a well understood context, a long standing link between health and housing. And I think the other thing that we've picked up is there are numerous examples of good practice that have been carried out by individual associations with individual organisations across the area, classes, healthy eating, and various others that we've run with many health agencies. I think one of the things, probably for me, particularly where I sit in terms of the housing world, is understanding the world of health and social care, because you might not understand us, but I think we struggle to work out. I mean, I think somebody did say, you know, it's like we speak different languages, and maybe part of the reason for again coming today is to try and see if we can understand a bit more about how your world works. If you can understand a bit more about how our world works, we can maybe help each other in the future. I won't particularly dwell on this, but again, with the city region combined authority, we've given a sort of a devolution agreement where we will work closely with the incoming mayor in terms of a range of things, but particularly these are two areas where not just about increasing housing supply and improving some of the housing that's currently standing, but we work also in terms of how we can assist in terms of worklessness and on health. And in the report that's in your pack, I think we've tried to highlight some areas where we think we have actually played a role. As I say, some of that good practice has happened in some areas, not being particularly rolled out. Is it something we can work more collaboratively on in terms of rolling these out in the wider area? So for instance, loneliness and isolation, very often we are out in our communities, visiting our tenants, dealing with issues. Sometimes it's the only people that some of our tenants see. And I'm sure there are very many issues in terms of health and social care where, again, can we actually pick that up and work more closely and maybe target some households? Or particularly from our information, it's about information sharing, which I think picked up from the last presentation, that we might be aware of the people that we can refer on. Falls prevention, I think there's been a number of examples working that. Dealing with dementia and pulmonary and cardiovascular issues. So, for instance, I have heard in some areas about GPs prescribing central heating systems for people that have been in cold and damp houses as a means of actually tackling some people's health issues. So, you know, is there something that we can look at in terms of schemes around improving people's current housing that means they can stay in the community rather than take up a hospital bed or whatever? I think picking up on poverty, many of our residents do have poverty issues, and we have an income team which is obviously focused on collecting rent, but we do an awful lot of welfare advice, and particularly with the welfare reforms that have come in, the famous bedroom tax or under occupation deduction, many people are struggling to keep a roof over their heads, and that can, I think, lead to health problems. Mental health problems. Another issue, many people are in fuel poverty where they're spending more than 10% of their income trying to heat their homes. We have, in many cases, done in some of our less well-performing homes in terms of fuel efficiency, done cladding schemes and other means of more insulation, which means it's actually cheaper for people to heat their homes. And many of our recently new built homes are built to sustainable housing standards, which again mean that they're well insulated and heating bills should be minimised. But clearly the whole issue of fuel poverty is a very much wider issue, and it's not just in the housing association sector. Clearly many people in private rented housing face similar issues. And again, one of the things we're talking to the incoming candidates for city mayor about is that 22 old housing associations, if we can come together and work something in terms of improving housing stock in the private rented sector, and potentially taking on more private rented accommodation that we can maybe bring up to better standards. I mentioned healthy lifestyles. Many sessions that are worked through in many of our tenants and residents associations is about trying to work with residents to improve themselves, as I say, in terms of healthy eating, smoking cessation, etc. The issue of mental health, which was touched on before. There are some specialist organisations. We're not particularly a specialist, we're a general organisation. There are very much about raising